Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here and to visit this beautiful city again. Each time I come here, I truly enjoy it. So I'm going to talk about non-contractible periodic orbits in Hamiltonian dynamics, and particularly so on closed symplectic manifolds. The talk is based on a joint work with Bashak Gorel, and actually this is three-fourths Gorel and one-fourth mine. There is a paper of Gorel something like 2013 and a joint recent preprint, so which I suppose when you do the math, it makes it like three-fourths Gorel. Other than that, actually, there are some other works, but in the context of Fleur theory, non-contractible periodic orbits on closed symplectic manifolds have not been studied much. Of course, non-contractible periodic orbits have been studied by quite a few people. So just to mention some names, I'm going to use the entire blackboard. So Biran, Polterovich, and Salomon, then Gatien and Lalonde, and Ijen Lee, and Cesar Nietzsche, and Weber, and probably quite a few more names I am forgetting now. But all these works are using a topological approach, Fleur theoretical invariants. And by the nature of being invariants, all these things vanish for closed manifolds, because on closed manifolds, you don't really don't need to have non-contractible periodic orbits, even when the topology of the manifold allows it. Say you can easily construct a Hamiltonian on the two-dimensional torus or any surface without non-contractible periodic orbits. So whatever conceivable Fleur theoretical invariant you may come up with will be zero, be it like Fleur homology or torsion or you name it. So all these works are mainly about open manifolds of this or that type. So my goal is actually fairly modest today. I just want to convince you that there are interesting things one can say about, from my perspective, interesting things one can say about non-contractible periodic orbits on closed manifolds, apart from the fact that they don't have to exist there. I also probably should mention Polterovich and Shiluchin and Hanevsky. Whose work is, particularly so with Polterovich and Shiluchin, is at least technically closer to what we do. So that was the introduction, and now I'm going to get right to business and state the first result. So let's start with notation. We have a closed symplectic manifold. I'm going to look at the space of set of free homotopy classes of loops. On M, this is not quite a group, but for any element which will usually be an denoted by F, its powers are defined. Just by taking a representative and iterating the loop. So for a loop x, I'm going to denote by x in square brackets the homology class. And by x in the blackboard brackets, the free homotopy class. So the homology class will be in H1 with Z coefficients mod torsion. And this thing, by definition, belongs to pi 1. And finally, the last piece. So this is kind of the notations about M. And finally, I have a Hamiltonian H, time dependent, say one periodic on time. I have a Hamiltonian flow and time one map. So I'm interested in k-periodic orbits of this time-dependent Hamiltonian flow. And particularly so, I'm interested in k-periodic orbits in a fixed homotopy class, in a given free homotopy class. So maybe let's denote this set by p sub k here is a period h, and then the class itself. Or I can put here maybe a collection of classes if I want to allow for more variation. So this is the notation part. Now, if you wish, the main theorem of the whole talk. All right, let it be here. So I'm going to assume that the form omega is a toroidal. That simply means that the integral of omega over any map from the torus to M is 0. For instance, this condition is satisfied for a surface of genus 2 or greater. And the background assumption is that H has a one periodic orbit x with non-trivial homology class. And moreover, I want to assume that it does not have too many one-periodic orbits. So I would maybe want to assume that the number of periodic orbits in the same free homotopy class as x is finite. For instance, non-degeneracy is a good condition that would imply it. Then the assertion is that for every sufficiently large prime, P, there exists a simple periodic orbit in the free homotopy class X iterated p times. And with period, and here we want to expect that the period is actually p itself. We cannot prove that much. It should be either p or the next integer after p, so the or p prime, where p prime is the first integer after p. Sorry. I didn't mean integer. I meant, of course, a prime number. I'm sorry. Yeah, right. So either with period p or p or the next prime. Most likely it's p, just don't know. Unfortunately, it's a proof by contradiction. So as all proofs by contradiction, it kind of has some intrinsic defects. So moreover, this condition, there is a slight sort of discord here between the assumption, which is about the homology class, and the conclusion, which is about the homotopy class. So it turns out that there is this moreover part. If pi 1 is hyperbolic and torsion free, one can assume that the free homotopy class of X is not trivial. This is a much weaker assumption than the assumption that the homology class is non-trivial. There are tons of homotopy classes with trivial homology classes. So this is the first theorem I want to show here. This is mainly Gorel and a little bit joined. So there is a kind of general principle underlying this theorem. And so principle is that whenever you have a periodic orbit that does not have to be there, so whenever there is an unnecessary periodic orbit, there are automatically infinitely many periodic orbits. So yeah, there are infinitely many. And then you can attach various like bells and whistles to this principle. For instance, you can control period, or you can control the homotopy class in this case, et cetera, et cetera. So this is quite a general principle. I think in various forms, it's Hofer and Zender, and also Gorel, depending on how you look at it. And this is quite useful. So this theorem is just one of many, of quite a few incarnations of that principle I know. I'm actually cheating here maybe a little bit. Let me assume that the orbit X itself is non-degenerate. And this condition can be weakened quite a bit. One can just assume that the local Fourier homology of X is non-zero. So X contributes to the homology in some form. So that's the theorem. Let me now discuss the assumptions here. So the manifolds for which these conditions are satisfied So examples of the manifolds. Of course, you can take a surface of genus greater than or equal to 2, or you can take any Keller manifold with sectional curvature negative. This will guarantee that the fundamental group is hyperbolic and torsion free. And there are also some other manifolds. Which meet the requirements of the theorem. Now, these are as far as the manifolds are concerned. So now, diffeomorphisms. So let's start with a free homotopy class. Then the set of EH meeting the requirements of the theorem, namely that there exists a non-degenerate orbit X with the free homotopy class, with a given free homotopy class, and the number of orbits in that free homotopy class is finite. So then this set of H is open, obviously, and non-empty, also more or less obviously. So at least there are Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms this theorem applies to whenever the fundamental group or the homology allows it. Now, nonetheless, how likely is it to happen? Having some Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms meeting the requirements of the theorem is not the same as having a lot of them. So how natural or unnatural this is? So here is a conjecture. So let's assume that pi 1 is sufficiently large. I don't know, hyperbolic torsion free. Some pi 1 to talk about. Maybe I should say good rather than large. Then, and an example I have in mind is a surface actually, maybe I would even say, of genus greater than or equal to 1. Then a generic H has a non-contractible periodic orbit. I'm not saying it has a one periodic orbit, of course not, but it has some non-contractible periodic orbit, perhaps of a very large period. And then I can sort of apply this theorem to a suitable iteration of H. So what I'm claiming is that, or what this conjecture is about, is that in fact this situation is generic. A remark is that certainly not true for all H, namely, if you take a self-indexing Morse function on a surface, so all saddles are on the same level, then its Hamiltonian flow has no non-contractible periodic orbits. Everything above index 1 and below index 1, well, the parts above and below index 1 are disks. And the second observation is that you cannot prescribe the homotopy class in advance. This is an easy consequence, at least for the surfaces of the KM theory. And because of that, let me specify actually C infinity generic. So I cannot tell what class, what homotopy class is realized. Now, effect so effect which I think Lokalves and Karapetsky explain to me that the conjecture holds, the conjecture holds for the torus. Unfortunately, there is a gap here because the theorem doesn't apply to the torus. Actually, none of the theorems I'm going to state today, actually, that's not entirely true. Most of the theorems I'm going to state today won't apply to the two-dimensional torus. But nonetheless, this is at least some indication that there is a merit to this conjecture. So this is a consequence of some non-trivial result of Lokalves and Karapetsky and Frank. So I'm certainly not an expert to comment on it. But that's something I want to keep in mind. And by the way, here is then a question. And is there an analog of theorem one, let's give it a number, for the two-dimensional torus? This is like one of the simple, the two-dimensional torus is probably one of the simplest manifolds one can think about. And I certainly don't know the answer to this question. Although I think it's feasible. Now, further results. Let's move to other classes of manifolds. And first, I want to think about the generic situation. Sort of assume you have, assume just as in the first theorem, assume you know you have one periodic orbit in some non-trivial homotopy class. So how likely are you to have infinitely many? Does it happen generically? It's not such a natural question maybe in the framework of symplectic topology, but I think outside symplectic topology, it is a very natural question to ask. So let me set some notation. So I'm going to consider two sets of Hamiltonians. Given a free homotopy class, so I recall that I have a free homotopy class here. So I'm going to look at all Hamiltonians, which are first of all non-degenerate, and also there exists a one-periodic orbit in the class F. So as we sort of, if we stick to this principle, we need this one periodic orbit just to talk about something. And inside this, I'm going to consider the set of Hamiltonians. There are infinitely many simple periodic orbits well, in F or F squared or F cubed and et cetera. So let's denote it F to the N, the set of natural numbers. This will be F to the K, K runs through N. So theorem two. So let's assume that no power of f is equal to 1. So let's assume that this set does not contain 1. So when I'm iterating x, or when I'm iterating f, I never end up with anything contractible. When I'm iterating this orbit x, it never becomes contractible. Then this set F infinity F is residual in the set of all such Hamiltonians. Residual, I always get confused between the first bare category and the second bare category. I think it's the first or the second. I mean, the big set is second bare. Residual means the second bare category. The countable intersection of dense and open sets. So within this set where there are non-contractible periodic orbits, an analog of theorem two holds generically for almost all Hamiltonians, virtually without any restrictive topological assumptions on the manifold. If you get one, you generically have infinitely many. Doesn't contain one. No power of f is contractible. Because this is a very non, it's a set, but it's highly non-abelian set usually. So I'm using multiplicative notation here.
What are the assumptions on the manifold?
Only this. There are no assumptions on the manifold at all. So this is a fairly generic phenomenon. For instance, when we look at the torus, where we know that this set is actually open and dense, we conclude that generically on the torus you have infinitely many, see infinity, generically you have infinitely many periodic orbits. I think probably people in dynamics know it. I would suspect that probably for surfaces, at least for the torus, it's known. I don't know for sure, but people in low dimensional dynamics might know. I would not try to sell it as a new result, but sort of coupled with the conjecture, it certainly says that generically you have infinitely many in a very broad situation whenever you can prove the conjecture. So now the proof of this theorem, this is a very easy theorem, and all these results have the same proof. I think it goes back at least to Hingston, and I learned it from Albert actually here in Rio many years ago. So the proof is that So here is the proof. Fluor theory tells you that one of the two things happens, at least one of the two. They are not mutually exclusive. That there is a non-hyperbolic orbit, or there are infinitely many periodic orbits in simple periodic orbits in this collection of iterated classes. And the reason is that because none of the iterated classes is contractible, the global Fluor homology is zero. So whenever you have this orbit x to the k, something has to cancel it. And so one or the either x or something canceling it has to be non-hyperbolic. There is a gap in this argument, and this is the point I learned from Alberta, which I'm not going to tell you what it is, you're sort of rewarded by contradiction. So, and once you have a non-hyperbolic orbit, there is a Moser-Birkhoff-Lewis theorem that Moser-Birkhoff-Lewis theorem that tells you that generically there are infinitely many periodic orbits and you can control homotopy classes. They actually all occur near the given orbit. So this is a very easy proof. I think it's been kind of rediscovered many times. The earliest reference I know is Nancy Hilton. Now let's move to, so that's the generic part. Now I want to try to extend the first theorem to a slightly broader class of manifolds. So let's say that M is toroidally monotone if the homology class of the symplectic form is proportional to the first churn with non-zero coefficient on all tori. So maybe I should say strictly toroidally monotone. But it doesn't, again, using symplectic topological terminology, it's either monotone actually or negative monotone. The coefficient lambda does not have to be positive. Just the two classes are proportional on all tori. And another notation I need is the minimal toroidal churn. Minimal toroidal first churn class. So by definition, this is the positive generator of what of the sub of the what I wanted to say is not entirely right. You take the first Turing class and start evaluating it on all tori. I wanted to say you get a subgroup in Z. In fact, I don't think it has to be a subgroup, but it's something that generates a subgroup in Z. And therefore, it is a cyclic subgroup. It has a positive generator, which can be infinity if the subgroup happens to be zero. And I call this generator the minimal toroidal. So examples of toroidal monotone manifolds are, here's an example. Let's take M of the form M1 cross M2. Here, the first one will be symplectically a toroidal. This simply means that omega and C1 are both zero on the on all tori. For instance, anything negatively curved is good. And M2 can be, I don't know, CPN or complete intersection of high degree is good too. Say it again. Oh, thank you. You're absolutely right. Yeah, M1, roughly speaking, M1 is from the first theorem. So think of anything negatively curved is good. And here I can either put the projective space or a complete intersection of a high degree. All right. Now let me state one theorem that is a possible generalization of kind of. All right. Let me backtrack a little bit. Sort of what we thought originally is that the very first theorem should literally hold for toroidally monotone manifolds. Later on, it turned out that there is an error in the proof, and I'm going to tell you what the error is, even sort of without telling what the proof is. One has to assume a little bit more. Just one non-contractible orbit is not enough. So one has to assume a little bit more about that orbit and the manifold. Here is one variant. So let's assume that M is toroidally monotone. And the minimal toroidal churn is not too small. It's 1/4 of the dimension plus 1, at least. These are the assumption of M. As for the Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, I wanted to have a hyperbolic orbit with non-trivial homology class. Then the conclusion is almost the same, that the Hamiltonian diffeomorphism has infinitely many periodic orbits in the collection of free homotopy classes generated by that orbit. So when I when I keep on iterating the Hamiltonian, there will be new simple periodic orbits occurring in the expected place, in the expected collection of classes. So one can actually, but of course, otherwise it's trivially true. Still, it's a correct statement. Thank you. So this condition that the homology class of X is non-zero, this condition can be replaced by that all the iterations of the class X are distinct and none of them is trivial.
Simple means that they're geometrically distinct or they're really simple?
It's high dimensional things. I understand. All right. Here is a note on terminology. Yes. Of course, when you do low dimensional dynamics, you can think of simple things in the sense not having self-intersections. I don't mean that. I mean simple, not iterated. Say it again. Has infinitely many simple, meaning non-iterated periodic orbit within this collection of free homotopy classes. And actually, all I need from this collection is that all entries in this collection are distinct and none of them is trivial. Not equal to one. So this is obviously true when the homology class is non-zero, but I could have just assumed that. This condition is satisfied, for instance, for the products of surfaces and projective spaces. And it's probably a technical assumption. All right, I also want to mention that there is a similar result for non-contractible periodic orbits of simplectomorphisms by Marta Batorio. So, all right, now in the remaining 15 minutes, I want to prove the first theorem, or at least outline the proof of the first theorem, and then say a couple of words how it extends to toroidally monotone manifolds, at least to the extent it does extend, like this thing. So let me recall what the setting is. So M omega is a toroidal. I have a one periodic orbit. And I don't want to bother with the moreover part of the theorem when the group is hyperbolic. It does require a little bit of hyperbolic group theory. So I'm going to assume that the homology class is non-zero. And let me assume that everything is non-degenerate. Everything. So let's denote the homotopy class of X by F. Just easier to write. Now I can tell you, I can restate the theorem. So given a prime P, large prime P, I want a simple orbit in F to the P, and with period P or P prime. The idea of the proof, the idea behind this principle is that whenever you have this unnecessary orbit, it sort of spawns infinitely many through some process. Sort of, this is like the seed which is supposed to generate infinitely many orbits. So let's consider the action on X, and by adding a constant to a Hamiltonian, I can always assume that, no, sorry, backtrack. As I said, this is a proof by contradiction. So we're assuming that the most likely thing, namely that I have a simple orbit in the class F to the P of period P, is not true. So I'm assuming that this is not true. Then every P periodic orbit has the form Y to the P, where Y is one periodic. And, well, let me assume for the sake of simplicity that Y happens in the same class as X. It doesn't have to. So one would have to get around this difficulty a little with some work. So let's say Y belongs to F. So all orbits that I care about occur in the same class in F. So this is an extra assumption. In general, there is no reason why it has to be true. So let's look at the action on X, which I can always assume to be zero. And let's take a little interval in R, which sort of isolates zero as a point in the action spectrum. So this is the interval. This is a small neighborhood of zero containing no other points of the action spectrum. Yep.
I'm lost.
So yeah?
If there is no
orbits
with period P,
then there are no simple orbits with period P, then every orbit with period P is iterated. Because P is prime, it has to be, so it's not divisible by anything. It has to be a one-periodic orbit iterated. And I'm assuming that this one-periodic orbits also occur in the same class F, just for the sake of simplicity. So I'm going to look at the action on X. Here one has to make some choices. And take an isolating neighborhood of this action containing no other points of the action spectrum. Now let's iterate the picture. So let's denote this interval by I. the Fleur homology, filtered Fleur homology for the interval I is non-zero. With my non-degeneracy assumption, when I iterate things p times, they remain non-zero. It remains non-zero. So HF of pi of my h to the p, let's write phi sub h to the p, is non-zero. Let's take now, okay. I did not say one important thing, namely that I'm looking at the Fleur homology, of course, for non-contractible orbits. So I want x to contribute. So here I'm looking for the Fleur homology at the orbits in the class F. And here I have to look at the Fleur homology for the class F to the P. Sort of. Pi. And the pth iteration of the Hamiltonian and the class F to the P. Let me now take the continuation map from the pth iteration to the next possible prime iteration. When you do the continuation between two Hamiltonians, the interval actually gets shifted by the Hofer norm of the Hamiltonian. So you have pi plus some constant. The iteration is the next prime. But continuation map actually preserves the free homotopy class. So the free homotopy class is f to the p. It's still the same thing. Now, let's undo the whole thing. I want to go back to HF of pi. I need to shift again by the same Hofer norm. So I'm getting 2c. This is a prime here. And this is phi to the prime fp. What we have diagonally here is the quotient inclusion map. I'm taking an interval and shifting it up. And there is a very natural map here. So let's see how things, what depends on what and how. The size of the interval pi is proportional to p. It grows linearly. The size of the shift, c, is the Hofer norm of the Hamiltonian you need to go from p to p prime. So this is O of p prime minus p, the difference between this, between the two consecutive primes. And this is O small of p. The difference between the primes grows much slower than the prime itself. So the shift I do here and I do here is much smaller than the length of the interval. So I'm taking a very large interval with non-zero homology and shift it upward just a little bit. Whatever I had the iterated orbit x here, x to the k, the action of it, it will still remain in there and there is nothing new. So this map is non-zero. Therefore, the intermediate group is non-zero. So I have p prime periodic orbits in the class f to the p. These two numbers are very mutually prime. It's extremely unlikely that these orbits would be simple. No, sorry, iterated. It's like when you take an iterated orbit and iterate it. To get here, you need to iterate it p prime times. To end, if in F to the P, just by looking at this condition that the homology class is non-zero, you would have to iterate it P times. So this really implies that there are simple orbits, period, P prime in FP. Hypothetically, it's I think it's even the way I did it, it's just downright impossible, right?
Is it local for homology or?
No, it's Fourier homology for this interval. It's filtered. Globally, homology is zero, but because you have one orbit, you get some interval for which the homology is non-zero, and the interval grows under iterations, and it grows much faster than the shift you need here. The key point to this argument is that the continuation map actually preserves the free homotopy class, doesn't take you out of it. So that's about the proof of the first theorem. So in this connection, actually, I want to mention that arguments of this type have been used actually many times before, and most recently by Polterovich and Shilyukhin for a different reason. And what they do, they actually frame it in the context of barcode theory. I don't really know how necessary it is, but certainly this type of questions with non-contractible periodic orbits lend themselves very nicely for persistent homology and barcode theory, because the total homology is zero. It's kind of a very nice playground for that. I don't know whether it would lead to any new results. I have no idea. Now, a word, say, about theorem three is that instead of using the action filtration, we use the augmented action filtration. Namely, let's take a non-contractible orbit. Let's take the action on this non-contractible orbit and subtract with a suitable coefficient the mean index of that orbit. We call it the augmented action. In general, so maybe I have to be more accurate here, because the action in this situation for toroidal monotone manifolds depends on the capping. Likewise, the mean index depends on the capping. But the difference is well defined. The difference is independent of any choices, if you do things right. Yes?
You're capping non-contractible.
I'm capping non-contractible orbits by fixing a reference loop, connecting things to the loop, and blah, 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 blah. Sort of imagine all the words I say. So then this difference is actually well defined. Now, the observation is that actually you get a genuine filtration on the Fourier complex if some conditions are satisfied. I should say sometimes. One can actually do the same thing in the monotone case, or negative monotone case. I just don't know how to use it, how to put it to use. So sometimes this thing gives rise to a genuine filtration, and it happens when the gaps between the actions are sufficiently large. For instance, if you start with finitely many orbits, and if you assume your Hamiltonian, again, this argument by contradiction, you assume your Hamiltonian has finitely many periodic orbits altogether, iterated sufficiently many times, the gap gets large. And then you have a genuine filtration. And then one can use this filtration in pretty much the same way as an ordinary action filtration, with one catch. And this is why theorem one does not generalize directly to the monotone case. So this action, this filtration is not strictly decreasing. So the differential can actually go from two orbits with equal augmented action. For instance, you can have several orbits with the same augmented action canceling each other. And this is the problem sort of that occurs, why the proof does not go through immediately in this case. We started with one orbit, but possibly there could be more orbits with the same augmented action, and they all cancel each other. So the filtered Fleury homology could be zero. So this is like why things get a little bit more subtle. And finally, I want to sort of emphasize that I think there are two. I want to finish with two questions. The first question, can one do anything like that for tori? So is there any theorem of that sort for even a two-dimensional torus, or better still, high-dimensional tori? And the second question is, I want to repeat, generic existence. The conjecture that was here. So these are, I think, two questions I think are interesting there. Say it again? Yeah, anything like theorem one, or maybe like this theorem. And there are some other theorems one can think about. So sort of. Just possibly say anything. Unfortunately, the torus is neither atoroidal nor toroidally monotone. I don't know any machinery that would kind of readily work for it. But I think generic existence is an equally interesting question, maybe even more important. Let me stop here. Thank you.